Hello. I think I saw
Hello.
you coming. Hi, Surat. How you doing? Hi, Maja. Well, the data community is here. Okay. Thank you all for coming in. I'm going to introduce our beautiful proactive speaker. So everybody, please put an emoji on your screen as we welcome Chisom. Chisom is an awesome person, our tech queen. She's a software engineer that works in Microsoft. She's based in Lagos, Nigeria. She is passionate about helping women come on board the tech sector as well. She was named the Rising Star of the Year by Women in Tech Network. Chisom, if I were to list all your achievements, she has a very great book called A Techie's Guide into Big Tech Companies, and she has basically been helping women, not just women, a lot of people come into the tech sector and get into the big tech companies. I think there's a word for it, but I've forgotten now.
Bang.
Today, the big five, right? Today,
Bang,
she
yeah,
will be teaching us how to structure our portfolios. So I know that some of us from the data community, we're fresh into it and we want to know how to, put ourselves out there to these companies properly. And one way we can do that is through our portfolios. So Chisom will be guiding us on how to, structure our portfolio and make it look professional and make it, give us an entry into the door. So thank you once again for coming on board, Chisom. Thank you, thank you, thank you. And over to you.
Okay, nice. Let me share my screen. Reason.
Again, everyone, please remember that we'll be having a Q&A session after her session. So if you have any questions during the session, please put it in this chat box and we'll get to it as soon as possible.
Okay, let's do this. So hi everybody, good evening. Hope you're having a good week. The week is almost up to an end, thank God. But yeah, I hope we're having a good week. I think Anita introduced me already. My name is Chiso. I'm a software engineer at Microsoft. I'm also an ex-intern at the Bank of America. I'm the author of a very beautiful book, like she mentioned, and I'm also a digital content creator. I am a YouTuber and I love creating content, lifestyle, tech, all of them join. So today we're going to talk about a very interesting topic. My role at Microsoft cuts across data engineering, big data, AI, and just around like building sustainable systems and all of that. So I think I've played for some time in a space where data is valued. And I would say that if you're on the call now and you're learning a field in data, trust me, you are in the right place. I won't say this everywhere, but just know that just know that data is something that's here to stay. So many people talk about artificial intelligence, oh, AI will take my jobs and all of that. But if you have a data-focused career, just know that you're always going to be at the forefront as a data engineer, as a data analyst, because someone has to extract that data. That's a data engineer, a data analyst. Someone has to interpret that data scientists as well. Someone has to like predict future outcomes. So having a data role is something that you should be very proud of, and it's something that you should always try to upskill in, no matter what. So today we're going to be talking about building a data portfolio, and this is what we're going to be doing today. We're going to start by explaining different data roles, because as much as these roles have like some similarities, I would want to try to like make sure you understand what exactly these roles in data do. Then we're going to look at how to create a winning portfolio, a portfolio that would not only help you land jobs, but a portfolio that will showcase your skill sets and just make you either be a thought leader in that space or just make people know that you know what you're doing, right? How to push your projects, how to showcase your projects, even how to choose projects that should be on your portfolio. They're going to be looking at low code website tools. Some people here might not be web developers. Some people here might not be software developers. So you might not have the skills required to start building websites from scratch with JavaScript and all of that. And then we're going to take questions and answers at the end. So I'd like to start with this. Your portfolio is not just a collection of your best work. It is a story of your growth as a professional. Your resume is going to have information about the work that you do and the work that you're proud of. But a portfolio is a more colorful space where people can just come and see everything about you. They can see your picture. I like to call portfolios a more friendly description about yourself. Resumes are so serious, like it's just text. Oh, I am this is my experience. But when you look at someone's portfolio, you're seeing a more artistic representation of that person, regardless of if the person has a technical role. You're seeing the person's picture, you're seeing the person's hobbies, you're seeing those beautiful dashboards, you're seeing links to code and all of that. So your portfolio is meant to reflect your growth as a professional. Your portfolio is meant to show people that this is what you know and this is what you've invested your career into building. It's something that you update. It's not something that's left stagnant. It's something that you put color into so that if you're going out and you don't really have time to give a pitch deck, you can say, oh, this is my website, www.chisomoku.com. Go there and find out more about me. And the person just goes to have like a look through of all your work in one place. So this is very important for everybody. So I'll be explaining some data roles. I know we probably have majority of data analysts in this room. We have data engineers and data scientists and all of that. So a data engineer is someone that makes credible data available by designing, maintaining infrastructure. So in simpler terms, data engineer is someone that builds pipelines, that maintains the systems that's feeding data into like the business and all of that. Now, when that data is brought in, transformed, I will call a data engineer someone who works mostly with big data, companies' data, people that are working at Meta, people that are working at Microsoft, people that are working at Google. You're playing with big data. I mean, just imagine how Google search is, for instance. Just imagine how much data is stored in Google search. So data engineer's job, an AI engineer, all of that, depending on the company, someone that builds systems that maintains the data and the infrastructure. So once the data comes in, you have the data analyst whose job is to focus on interpreting that data and drawing insights from that data. For example, your YouTube channel, someone is definitely going to be in charge of showing you the metrics of, like, if you have a channel like myself, you can see a metrics of people that are watching your channel. Are they more males than females? Are people from Nigeria watching your channels more than people from the United States? That's what a data analyst would do. Then a data scientist is someone that's responsible for extracting knowledge and insight from this data through advanced analytics and machine learning. So you're talking about like predicting insights, building machine learning models, and all of that. So these roles can intertwine a bit depending on the company. But why I'm doing this is that it's important to know your role as a data engineer or a data analyst or a data scientist. This would help you give like a more intentional structure while you're building your portfolio. You know what the company is looking for and you know what to give them or you know what to show to them, so you're not confused literally. Then why do you need data portfolio? Like I mentioned, you want to highlight your expertise. You want to highlight your expertise in analytics, data analysis, computer science, if you're an engineer, programming languages, and so much more. So it's very important. So how do you create a winning portfolio? The first thing I would want to do is give you a sample job requirement. This is a sample job requirement description I got from LinkedIn. And this job was trying to employ a junior data analyst. So we're all building a portfolio to brand ourselves, right, as data professionals, but the major reason why people build portfolios is to get jobs, right? And so you don't want to not show people what they need to see. I always keep telling people that if employers are looking for something and they're not seeing that on your portfolio, on your resume, then you're showing them that, oh, you might not really be a good pick for that job, right? So in order for us to know how to build a winning portfolio, we need to know what employers are looking for. So this is a sample job description for a data analyst. The first thing is they're asking you for an experience, you're going to dive deep into large business data sets to uncover valuable insights that can be turned into actionable hypotheses. The second thing is building dashboards, reports, and visualizations to allow others at the company to ask the right data questions. Work with product owners, specialists to determine and measure the right metrics, and educate and empower others at the company to be more self-reliant. So this is what a company is asking for. This is what they require of you as a data analyst. And so you can interpret the first requirement as exploratory data analysis. If a company is asking you to uncover valuable insights from data that you're using, then that means you need to have experience with EDA. You need to showcase experience with EDA in your portfolio. If a company is asking you to build dashboards and reports, that means you need to showcase your experience building dashboards and visualizations in your portfolio. If a company is asking you or expecting you to know how to work with product owners and specialists, you need to show the experience you have collaborating with people in your portfolio. And network. Is that someone that will work? Okay. Are we good now?
Yeah, I hear you now. Go ahead.
Oh, okay. So the last thing is a company wants you to educate and empower people at the company to be more self-reliant for their data needs. So this translates to maybe articles or blog posts. So this is like a sample description for what a company needs from you. And things like EDA, dashboard building, collaboration, articles and blog posts have to be reflected on your resume because this is like a typical requirement for a data analyst, right? So when you have all this in mind, you know that, okay, this is what the job market requires. This gives you a more intentional drive into building a portfolio that's not just that won't be redundant, but something that will actually give value to the people that are looking at it. Sorry. So how do you start, right? If you want to build a portfolio, you don't just randomly pack all the things that you've learned, maybe in your Wentors mentorship program. You don't just pack everything and put inside your portfolio. You have to be very intentional about the things that you are displaying on your portfolio. So let's look at how you can choose a data set, right? When you're picking a data set, forget about like the fancy modeling that you're going to do with the data set, but pick data sets that are more interesting to look at, data sets that tell impactful stories. Because when someone's looking at your portfolio, you are not inside your portfolio talking to the person. The person is only reading what you have there. So your data set has to tell stories that are impactful, have to tell stories that are interesting. I know there are a couple of data sets that are already flying off the roof, but I would always suggest that don't pick a data set that is too common. I know as data analysts, I know that there are common ones like I think Adventure Works, Titanic, and all of that. Those data sets are good, but it kind of like shows you're still a beginner. It's just like all these dummy projects that we build when we just get started in tech. Everybody has built it. The whole world has built it. So imagine putting that same thing into your portfolio as a data set. Nobody will actually take you seriously. So look for data sets that tell impactful stories. And I think I have a sample here. This is a data set that shows I think this was from 2016. This is a visualization that shows the HIV prevalence in Amsterdam. Merely looking at this, I can tell a story from this. I don't need to be there in front of like the person looking at my portfolio. The person can see this map and also see the little like storytelling or description that I'm putting beside it, and the person can draw insights from it. So you didn't just only work on a random data set. You're using a data set that's telling a story that's more interesting and relatable to look like. And I think this was very rampant during like the COVID-19 period, where people were steadily getting data for countries that are suffering from COVID-19, the ones that are not really experiencing a lot of death rate and all of that. So picking the right data set would actually help you when doing your portfolio. Then other things that would also showcase your data cleaning and data transformation skills will be looking for a messy data set. If you want to shine in the analytics space or in the engineering space or even the science space, you need to look for things that would make you do the work, that will get your hands dirty, right? It's the integral part of analysis. So don't look for data sets that are already set up, that are already arranged for you. You understand, like they're already clean and you just dive in to start getting insights. If you want to grow, if you want to experience growth, like in your career as a data professional, look for a messy data set, clean it up. The good thing about this is once you're done with the cleaning and the transformation, you can even add that into your portfolio to show that this data set wasn't quite ready, but you did the work in terms of like cleaning and transformation. And this is you showcasing your cleaning and transformation skills. So if you have a messy data set against like an organized data set, go for the messy one so you can add that experience as well into your portfolio. Other things would be your project outline. I know there are so many projects that you would work on, especially for the people in the analytics space. You're going to build a lot of beautiful dashboards, but you need to know how to structure it. You need to know the exact things that should be there. So the first thing is the name of the project. Of course, the project should have a name. The objectives of the project. Why did you do that project? What does that project explain? What is that project trying to find? What was your problem statement? What was your task? What was the main reason you started driving insights from that project? So it might be a movie. It might be war-torn areas. It might be Spotify. But list out the objectives of that project and the things that you wanted to achieve with that project. Now, don't forget to put a linked data set that you use. That's very important as well. And the other things your project should have is the tools that you use, the programming languages. Did you use R? Did you use Python? Did you use Scala? Did you use Jupyter notebooks? Did you use Power BI or Tableau? Like, those things have to be stated, because most of the time, employers want to know the kind of skills that you have. They want to know the kind of tools that you have. So please try to always state the tools that you used. Put a link to the data set. And the objectives are very important. Write down the questions you want that data or you had in mind for that data to answer. So it gives you like more, a more concise description of your project. And also something I forgot to add was storytelling as well. If you're writing down a project or if you're drafting out a project, try to start it with a story. Let people, entertain people with that story. Just follow them through on that journey of storytelling. Storytelling in data is another workshop on its own. So, but it's very important that you know how to tell a story. You don't need to be present in the room to start talking, but if you can write a compelling story to just captivate the person's attention, and the person is now more interested to know exactly what your visualization is doing, and it just gets interesting from there. Other things would be create appealing visuals as well. Make your visualizations interactive and colorful, but also make it look professional. I've seen a lot of visuals. I've seen a lot of like dashboards, and I'm like, what is this? Sorry, but as much as possible, I usually envy designers that transition from design to like the analytics space, because if you see their dashboards, you know that they are putting in the experience they had as designers, the colors, the fonts. So as much as possible, I know people are more they are more, how do I put it now? They're more comfortable with numbers. I know people that love numbers a lot, like people that love math, statistics. They don't really like the whole color, font, and all of that. But still try as much as possible, because no matter how good your analysis is, if what I'm seeing is not appealing to my eyes, I wouldn't want to look at it, right? So if you can even take visualization classes, that would help. If you can use, I know that there are so many websites that have like already, like color combinations, like color palettes that you can just steal from that, put in your visualization. But please make it as appealing as possible. Then if you want to make it interactive, you can put like, I know Power BI has like a date filter where you can filter for date, where you can click stuff and stuff just happen. Just try to make it as interactive as possible, so it looks very, very nice and professional as well. Storytelling is key, like I mentioned. Use your data, leverage your data to craft a narrative that would effectively communicate your insights to the person that is reading your portfolio, or to the person that is using your portfolio. So like I mentioned, you're not there, you're not in front of your laptop saying something, but everything still depends on what you write down. Everything still depends on what the person is reading. So try to use your words to communicate effectively, to make sure that you're not short-selling yourself, you're doing like the most, and people can see that, okay, what you actually did is very impactful and it drives a lot of value. So storytelling is also very important. So yeah, you've picked a data set, you have built dashboards with that. How do you push your projects? How do you showcase your projects? Where do you host them? Is it GitHub? Is it a Power BI dashboard platform? How do you push it? So the first thing is for visualization projects, Tableau and I think Power BI has like platforms where you can actually create accounts and host all your dashboard visualizations. So I would have opened one now, but I'm not sure if I can find it really quick. But if you click on like your Tableau link, you can see dashboards or sample dashboards that people have built. So all those dashboards will be under your name and your portfolio, your profile as well, what you do, and the description behind those dashboards. So for visualization projects, you can use either of these two to host all your visualization projects under one umbrella. That's for visualization. Then, this is a sample of someone's Tableau account. So if you notice, her name is there, her location, all the visits that she has done, people that follow her, And I feel like if you click on any of these dashboards, you can see like a more descriptive storytelling technique used behind all these dashboards. So this is something you can have. Your link to your LinkedIn link as well would be there, and your picture as well. So this is where you can host all your dashboards under one umbrella. Then for EDA projects, for exploratory data analytics project, most of the time, employers would like to see those colorful, nice dashboards, but most of the time they would want to see the code behind that. So you can use GitHub to host your code if it's very long. I know that there's some analysis that people do that can be very lengthy and all of that. So you can use GitHub. You can also use your notebooks as well, your notebooks accounts to host those lines of code. Then for educative concepts, like I mentioned, if you remember in the first description that we did for jobs, the last thing there was impacting knowledge, teaching people different things. So as a data analyst, if there's new knowledge that you found, or if there's something that you struggled with and you ended up fixing it, try to write about it. It actually shows that you can impact knowledge. It shows that you know what you're doing. And I keep telling people, you cannot give what you don't have, right? It gives people this impression that you can teach. And before you teach, you have to understand. So for every concept that you write about, people know that you are a thought leader in that space, right? So if you learn anything new, or if you feel like there's something that you can contribute to the ecosystem, please try to write about it. Try to host your articles on Medium. This helps a lot. I mean, it has helped me a lot. So I know that it will help you. So yeah, we have, you've written your code on EDA. You've posted it on GitHub or notebooks. You have your dashboard on Tableau. You have your Medium articles. So how do you put all those things together? So this is where your portfolio website comes in. A website will definitely allow you to connect all these links together in one place. And it also showcases your technical and soft skills in more detail. So on this, your website, what should your website have? The first is the About Me, obviously. I would always advise, try to make this as fun and as interactive. I mean, this is not your resume, but just try to make the person feel like they sort of like know you, right? Then your skill set is something that you shouldn't miss, because it's something that's very important for things ranging from programming languages. If you're conversant with Python, SQL, R, please only put the things that you're conversant with so you don't set yourself up for failure. Then in terms of visualization, like Power BI, Tableau, you can add that as well. Then other things, like there are other skill sets that are necessary for a firm that's in analytics space or data science or data engineering, please add that as well. Your work experience, if you've done any work as a full-time employee for any company, you can add that there as well. The good thing about portfolios is that your resume has limited space, but on your portfolio, you can express yourself as much as you can. You can talk about your work experience, talk about what you did as much as you can. Put in your interest there as well. If you're a data analyst and you have had some courses in data science that you are trying to transition, or you just want to learn more about maybe machine learning or AI, you can add that in your interest as well. Testimonials, if you've worked for people, if you've done freelance work for people, or if you volunteered to act as a data professional in a particular setting or hackathon or anything, you can add that there as well. Then qualification, if you've taken exams, like most of you guys are on data camp, so data camp will definitely give you certifications. You can add that there as well so that it can be visible to anybody that's looking at your portfolio. So yeah, you might be asking, okay, how do I build my website? I think I was in this boat because when I started my tech journey, I didn't start with web development. So let's say fortunately or unfortunately, I didn't start with web development. So I started with Android development. I usually build apps on my mobile phone. So I did I used a no-code website tool because I didn't know how to build a website. And luckily for me, there are so many tools online. I use Wisk because it was very easy to navigate. There's Squarespace, there's GoDaddy. So you don't have to start killing yourself or even trying to pay a web developer to just help you. This is something that you can do and design on your own. So I would say that when you open a Wix account or a Squarespace or a GoDaddy account, the first thing you do, obviously, is put in your picture, About Me section, then moving down to your work experience. But this is where all your links come in, the link to your dashboard page, the link to your GitHub account, the link to your Medium account. And if you feel that you can even bring some of those dashboards to your main portfolio, good and fine, that would even be better. So you can explain it more and you don't have to make people go to another site to look at stuff, right? So if you have like 10 dashboards on your Tableau account, you can pick like the best three or the best two that will be reflected on your portfolio, where you can explain like storytelling and all of that, and the tools, the objective, like we spoke about in the other slide. And then you can now put a link that would redirect them if they want to see more dashboards that you have built, right? So I know I'll be talking a lot about data analytics for data scientists and data engineers. Most of the time, you don't build dashboards, right? You would be working on mostly infrastructure, maybe on Azure, AWS, GCP. And it's not like you can leave those things there because these cloud platforms are paid for. You have to use them and delete like all your resources, all your other stuff. So I would always advise going the architecture route. If you built a pipeline, if you built a certain kind of infrastructure that does something, try to document it using, there's this, I think, draw.io, where you put like icons. You're trying to explain to the person looking at it that, okay, I built this project, I hosted it on Azure. These are the tools that I used. This is the pipeline. This is what this does. And this was the end product. And you not only draw that outline, you're writing like a very descriptive article on what the project did, right? So let's say you put some data into your storage account. you created a Python script that transformed the data, you created another pipeline that moved that data to somewhere else. You have to explain all these things here, right? So for data scientists as well, I know your role revolve around building models and all of that, but documentation will shine mostly in this field. Write a lot of articles, have like a space where you document things or infrastructure that you've built, and just keep building from there, right? So I think, yeah, so the last thing I would say is every piece in your portfolio is a chapter in the book of your career. Make each chapter worth reading. Open your portfolio. Let me want to employ you. Let me see you as a very interesting person. Try not to make it as serious as possible. Make it fun. Make it playful. There's some portfolios that you open, you won't want to leave them because they are really captivating. So you want to keep people on your portfolio and you want to make people refer you using your portfolio. So make each chapter worth reading, and it's not a process that you should rush. Just take your time to make sure that the most important things are on your portfolio. So yeah, wishing you the best of luck. Thank you for coming to my, how does it, TED Talk. But thank you for listening to my session.
It's what it's a 10 o'clock. But yeah, thank you so much, Chisom. Again, you always drop golden nuggets for us. I said this last time, but I'm saying it again. But if you love the session with Chisom, please put your heart emojis on the screen. Just show us how much you appreciate it before we start taking, you know, questions. Thank you so much. I even have a question, to be honest, but let's start off with the ones in the chat box. So we have one from Julietta Rubis, and she said, do I need to be best in calculus, linear algebra, and probability theory to become a data analyst or machine learning engineer? You're muted.
I don't know how to answer this question. but I will lie. Let me give an instance. Somebody posted something on Twitter yesterday that I found really insightful. And the person said, my statistics degree helped me in this Excel stuff I was doing. So the guy was working on an Excel stuff and he wanted to do some computation. And he was just posting formulas that he was solving to make sure that the Excel stuff works fine. And this is someone that you know that is very passionate about mathematics and statistics as well. I wouldn't say you should be best in it, but it's something that you should appreciate. The thing I've noticed about people that love math and statistics and numbers and all of that, the way I'm talking, you know that I am not so... I'm not so like deep into the whole math and statistics thing, but it's something you have to appreciate. If you want to come to the data space, you have to appreciate how these things work. You have to appreciate, because if you're becoming a machine learning engineer, well, everything you're going to do is going to revolve around building models. And trust me, those models would involve serious mathematics. You're going to talk about decision trees, probability, like you mentioned, linear algebra. So I feel like it's something that you should appreciate, but should you be like really good and best in it? I don't think so. But it's something that you should appreciate and do a lot of research in, so you appreciate the machine learning that you're even doing, or even data analysis that you're doing. So yeah, if it's something that you love, you've seen it and you're passionate about it, please go ahead and just do it, right?
Thank you for that. So our last question here is, in building my portfolio, does it have to be a data that hasn't been used before? What if I have worked with a data that has been worked on before?
I feel like all the data on the internet has been used by at least one person. Especially when it comes to like people scrape data a lot, like people have data sets that are online that have been used by multiple people. So like I mentioned, if you can do like go for messy data instead and just do your thing with it, because what someone will do with data is not what you would do with data. You would bring in your own insights, you bring in your own style to the whole thing. So it's always going to be unique when it comes to individuals, but it doesn't mean that, oh, if someone has used this data, I shouldn't use it. But try to avoid data that has been overused. You know, when you come into the space, they're giving you data sets in your bootcamp or your tutorial. This is something that beginners have used to come into the field and to practice as well. So if you want to put something in your portfolio, I wouldn't advise that you should use that, but rather go for something that's maybe probably web scraping or just something that's solid, something that's more messy that can get your hands dirty with. Yeah, so.
Okay, thank you. We have a question from Yira. She says, for a digital marketer, what tool would be great in building a portfolio?
Like I mentioned, I think those no-code tools are good.
Mm-hmm.
But as much as they are good, they have their limitations. You will not compare them to people that are using, that actually using JavaScript and all these interesting frameworks to build websites. So you have some limitations. But if you don't really have the budget to like pay somebody to build a portfolio for you, then you can use them. You could just play around with it. They also have templates as well that you can buy, like you can purchase if you don't want to design something from scratch. So whether it's digital marketing or any other thing you're doing, you can get templates from those local tools that I mentioned, and you can just customize it to fit like your own style.
To sneak in my question in there, do you think Notion is a great platform to build a portfolio as well?
I haven't built a portfolio on Notion, but I don't think their interface is it like website-ish, or it's just like the usual
Notion? Yeah, I think it can expand.
Oh, it can expand. Oh, okay. Okay, I think it just depending on your style. There are some portfolio sites that don't really have a lot for me. But I know that there are some that have like very solid templates that you can buy. But yeah, so either of them works. I mean, it just depends on you, but just try to make it as interesting and not so simple, not so basic. Just try to put some color into it.
Okay. All right. So we have one more question here. It says, where can I source for interesting data sets? Kaggle doesn't really have much for me. Thanks.
I can't really think of a website on top of my head, but there's a YouTube video that I watched where they did like a review of data sets that people don't really use because a lot of messy data is there. So people go for Kaggle because it's easier to go through. So I don't know if I could share that later. If I could just find it later, I'll just share it with you. Yeah, so you could check it out.
Right. Okay, that's the questions that we have here. If we have any more questions, please, this is the time now to maybe unmute. If we have any more questions, I want Chisom to say, oh my God. Okay, Maja is saying, what about Data Camp portfolio page?
Okay, I'm not sure what that means. Is it like
Maja, please, can you expand on that question and feel free to unmute? Hello? So I'm guessing she's saying if the Data Camp portfolio page would be great to display portfolio. But I don't think it can work long term, if that's what she's asking.
Oh, okay. I don't think I've checked. I know Data Camp, but I don't think I've checked like their portfolio. But that might be a problem if like your subscription is over and stuff like that. Yeah.
Definitely.
Yeah. So you could just go for something, and you also need like a domain name as well. Like you need to buy a domain name like with your name, like the whole www thing. So I think when you go to Namecheap, these no-code tools just help you do all that background work. So that might be a better route.
Okay. All right. If we have no more questions, please, again, let us appreciate Chisom by putting on our emojis on the screen. She really came in with her A game as usual. Thank you so much. Thank you so much, Chisom, for coming in. We really do appreciate you as a community. I see all our data camp learners here, and I'm glad everybody's here. Please, can we turn on our videos? I would love to see yours. Hi, Maja. Can I see you? Julieta. Hi, Dorothy. I see you. I just... Hi. Let's all turn on our videos for a picture before we go. Hi, Zuma. Sarah, you're looking beautiful. Thank you, thank you, thank you. Chisom has done a wonderful job, so we want to do a little bit of cheese and then we head out. Hi, Grace. I think everybody's shy today. Yira, hi. I'm looking forward to seeing what we have on the community. I know we're going to chat about it. So, yeah. Thank you so much, Chisom. Again, I know. Oh, hi, Julieta. Looking pretty. Okay, are we all ready? Let's just say a little bit cheese. Cheese. Thank you so much, Chisom. And I look forward to having you, maybe not again, not soon, but yeah, we look forward to having you back again. Thank you so much. And yes, we'll be sharing the playback to the community. So check the platform, check your emails, and have a wonderful, wonderful evening. Thank you so much, Chisom. Bye, everyone.
Bye. Bye, everyone.
Bye.
All right, thank you very much.
Yeah, thank you. Bye. Bye.